Hey, what's going on, everybody? Welcome to another edition of Virtual Learning with Mr. Viveris. Today is Wednesday, May 20th, 2020, so 5-20-2020. Say that 10 times fast. Going to kick it off with some music today. As you can see, we're going to start out with some Marky Mark, Good Vibrations. Marky Mark, you guys might know better off today as Mark Wahlberg, who you probably know more so as a famous actor. His acting career, let's face it, Mark, your acting career was much better than your music career. I think this was your only hit. But you do represent the state of Massachusetts very proudly, and I'm grateful for that. And here we go, kick it off. Some good vibration, as you can see, feeling pretty energetic today.
Yeah. Can you feel it, baby?
Forget exactly how jacked Mark Wahlberg is. Jesus, man, that guy is ripped. He's still ripped today. I was actually reading an article about him the other day, and it said he gets up every day at like 3 o'clock in the morning and works out for an hour and then takes a break and then has breakfast and works out again. Like, I guess I think he's probably 50 now. Jeez. I think that song it said was made in 1991. So we're going back 29 years. Mr. V was just a wee little boy. Only 4 years old when that song came out, but every time I hear it, you know, you hear that song, kind of brings back that nostalgia. A lot of songs just, you know, hit you right where you remember. All right, so today is Wednesday, as we can see, May 20th. Sorry, they are doing some yard work today. It seems like Wednesday is the day they're going to be, doing the landscaping around here. But going to start off with a question of the week update, then get into Mr. Rogers' Two Truths, One Lie competition. And hit you with some new material on Google Classroom. I'm sharing my annotations with you guys via a photo gallery, so we'll be checking that out during today's video, but I do wanted you guys to know if you see that in today's post. Then we're going to get into day 8 by revisiting Soul Painting, Inc. by Meg Medina, by reviewing a Prezi that takes a look at the plot summary, provide you with some details about the setting, the characters, themes, as well as some guiding questions to help you guys make the connection between this text and our essential question. Then we're going to review those annotations I was just talking to you guys about. We'll get into the guided reading questions, so I'm going to complete the guided reading questions with you. And then we're going to preview the assessment questions, which are numbers 1 through 5, tomorrow. We are going to be getting into the Unit 1 essay draft. All right, so I got some fun and exciting things coming up for you guys tomorrow in regards to your essays, which I'm really looking forward to seeing what kind of ideas you guys pull from these texts. There's been some great claims I've been able to see online, and yeah, it's pretty encouraging. So let's bring it back over to Ground Zero here. Mr. V's humble abode, his compound here in the corner of my bedroom. So let's talk first about the question of the week update. Not much to report in terms of fluctuations and numbers. Looking at about the same involvement so far this week as yesterday. So with that being said, guys, we got to step it up. Last week, y'all had, you know, 23 engagements. This week, we're only at a pathetic 11. But I got to remain optimistic. It is only Wednesday. You guys just set the bar so high for me when I woke up yesterday morning. But right now, it's looking like 7 Yale. You guys are stuck at 7 engagements, 7 Harvard. You guys are up to 4. So hopefully we can continue to increase these numbers and hopefully break last week's record and perhaps even crown a new champion, which 7 Yale, you guys look like you're on your way to doing that. Next, I'd just like to remind you, if you haven't already, make sure to compete in Mr. Rogers' Two Truths, One Lie competition. Again, you can access the Google form through Google Classroom. It's under the Virtual Learning Week 9 worth of materials. It has its own post. Make sure to get involved. It's a great opportunity to win $25, excuse me, to Dunkin' Donuts. Drinking a rain. These things have clearly a ton of carbonation because I just got a ton of burping going on. Anywho, last tidbit of news is just to tell you folks about the Soul Painting Ink annotations, which I shared with you all by creating a photo gallery. My annotations will not save on Common Lit. So I've decided, well, what better way to make those annotations a bit more accessible other than through viewing the video than by just providing you guys with a gallery kind of slideshow that will, you know, show you folks my annotations. So with that being said, going to start off by getting into the Prezi that Miss Reynolds created for us. So I'm going to project this to you guys. And here it is. All right, so this is the Soul Painting Ink Prezi that was created, again, by Miss Reynolds. Miss Reynolds has been putting together some excellent materials for you guys. She was the person who shared the video the other day, as you know, for We Wear the Mask. She also shared the Prezi for the mustache. And it's not that she shared these materials. Again, she's creating them, which I think is excellent. And I'm very much appreciative of that. And I hope all the students out there who've been using these materials are finding them useful, because I certainly am. All right, so we're going to start by talking about the settings. So again, we have the setting, characters, summary, themes, and guiding questions. So we're going to start it out by looking at the setting to just get us back grounded and revisiting the story's main plot. So the setting, again, the story takes place in the West Palm Beach, Palm Beach area of Florida. It's August and very hot. All right, just to remind you, Mercy, Poppy, and Rolly, they all live in West Palm Beach, which is, you know, more like a city, all right? If I had to compare, I'd say, you know, it's probably like Fall River, whereas Palm Beach is kind of like a rich area. I would kind of say it's kind of like Somerset, all right, where it's, you know, people tend to have a bit more money, all right? So that's the difference between West Palm Beach and Palm Beach. But then also keep in mind, it's August, it's very hot, and I think we're about a week out from school. The characters visit a rich private school in the rich area of Palm Beach. Again, the name of that private school is Seaward Pines. They also go to their rundown apartment building. Again, we kind of get the description that they don't live in the best of areas in West Palm Beach, based on their early description of Mercy and Rolly's condo. And then they also describe the pool. And I'm so pumped that Miss Reynolds showed this picture of this filthy pool. Absolutely disgusting. If you recall, Rolly, towards the end of the story, grabs the net and flings a frog, which I thought was a bit cruel, out of the pool. And then you also see, you know, some mansions here, just to kind of give you guys an idea of the difference between West Palm Beach and Palm Beach. All right, let's continue on and take a look at the characters. So So what we have here is a diagram that kind of just breaks down some of the characters that we have in this text. First, we'll start with Mercy. Mercy is the protagonist, right? She's the hero, the good guy, if you want to consider her the good guy in this story, if you're into that whole, good versus evil stuff. But, the technical word would be protagonist, right? The protagonist is the hero. She's also the narrator of this text. She's entering seventh grade. She's Hispanic. She's going to a fancy private school because she was not excelling in her previous school. Recall that, mommy and Poppy felt it'd be better for her to go to a more structured learning environment, which is why they want her to attend Seaward Pines. And she also dreams of taking over her dad's painting business. All right. Let's talk about Poppy. So speaking of Poppy, her dad, Mercy and Rolly's father is Poppy. He's a painter. He's divorced from their mother. All right, so let's keep that in mind. That Poppy and Mommy are divorced. Poppy made a deal with Seaward Pines to paint the gym for Mercy to go to school for free. All right, so again, he arranged that deal to cover her tuition. In exchange, he would paint the gym. He's known to have a temper, but does not show it when the soccer girls make a mess. Again, according to Mercy and her perspective and the narration she provides, she, kind of builds Poppy up as this, kind of no-nonsense type of person who does have a temper, which is probably why she's so shocked by the fact that he doesn't react or hold the soccer team accountable for their behavior. Next, we have Rolly. Rolly is Mercy's older brother. All right, Rolly is in 12th grade. Mercy is going into 7th grade. Rolly's going into 12th grade, I should say. Excuse me. He's on a scholarship at Seaward Pines, meaning that he goes there for free because he is very smart. All right, let's not forget, all that talk about him being very much into science early on in the story. We do get the sense that, he is super intelligent, which is why he's able to attend Seaward Pines, right? It's because he got in on a scholarship, which means he goes there for free. Which also tells me that Pappy and Mommy probably don't have much money of their own. Rolly, again, is entering 12th grade. He helps support Mercy's schoolwork, and he's empathetic to Mercy's feelings. Now, again, you may recall that during yesterday's video, I kind of highlighted that sentence that Mercy said that Rolly never gives her a break, which I totally disagree with. Again, I think if we were to get the story from Rolly's perspective, we probably see that he has a lot he gives Mercy a lot of breaks. All right. Oop, sorry about that, guys. Next, we'll get into the soccer girls. The soccer girls are the older students of Seaward Pines, right? If we were to say, there's an antagonist or a villain in this story, it would be the soccer girls. They make a mess of the wet paint and don't care. They're rude, inconsiderate, and potentially racist. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that they go to this ritzy school and they probably get a lot of those, a lot of those behaviors and a lot of those values from their parents where they kind of look down upon poor people, which is totally wrong. All right, I disagree with that. And also why they're potentially racist. Let's not forget that they tended to mock the language that Mercy, Rolly, and Poppy were speaking in. So the minor characters of the text are Mammy, who is Mercy and Rolly's mom. We have Mr. Falco. He's the Seaward Pines guidance counselor. He told the family about the school. He does nothing when the girls make a mess. All right, so he's the person who kind of shows up after the girls have made a mess of the gym. And then we have Mrs. McDaniels, who Mercy meets when she first arrives at the school. She's the school secretary. She's not very welcoming, and she acts very superior. If I recall correctly, Mercy describes her as being kind of like an enforcer. So she's a bit intimidated by Mrs. McDaniels. All right, let's continue on, shall we? Let's get to the summary. So the summary is broken down nicely because, again, this is a very long text. As you can tell, yesterday's video was about an hour because it took us a long time to get through reading the text. So if you need to go back and check that out, there were a lot of times I stopped and kind of helped to guide your understanding. But anywho, let's get to the summary. So this is a summary of the plot. Again, all plots have a beginning, middle, and end. So thank you, Mrs. Reynolds, for putting this together because I think this summarizes the text very nicely. So in the beginning, Mercy and her brother Rolly are picked up by their dad, Poppy, to help with a painting job. Mercy explains she does not like school and wants to take over her father's business one day. Mercy explains how she will be going to the Seaward Pines School next year, a rich private school. her brother Rolly already goes there and is on scholarship because he is smart. So again, her brother goes there for free. And let's not forget, you know, I would just add this in, perhaps that they are on their way to a secret job, right? Mercy and Rolly don't know about it. Poppy is taking them there. So in the middle is where we, you know, kind of have that revelation. It says Poppy takes them to Seaward Pines for the paint job. Again, they didn't know they were going there originally. He made a deal with the school that Mercy could attend there for free if he painted the gym. He made the deal to help Mercy do better at school. They paint the gym, but right after, the varsity girls soccer team does not read the signs and makes a mess of the wet paint. They do not apologize, and they are rude. Mercy expects her father to get mad, but he doesn't. And in the end, Mercy is upset with her dad for being silent and not standing up for himself. If you recall, she kind of gives him the silent treatment the whole way home. And she's kind of glad that he understands, like, that she's upset. But again, maybe she should have been a bit more or a bit less stubborn, right? Maybe she should have asked him, you know, why did you do that, Dad? I'm sure he would have explained, right? Rolly explains that he sacrificed his pride and feelings so she would not lose her free spot at the school. So instead of Dad being able to explain his point of view, Rolly explains it for him. So perhaps it's difficult to understand other people's points of view because we don't, perhaps it's difficult to understand other people because we don't recognize their point of view. All right. And we often don't recognize people's point of view because we're too stubborn. We're too stuck in our own ways. And rather than ask them, we just kind of, you know, remain quiet, which is what Mercy did. All right. Let's continue on now to the themes. So here are some possible themes of the story. So one is helping family is more important than personal pride. So thinking about Poppy's actions, right? He helped his family and kind of, sacrificed his own pride for Mercy, right? That was his whole motivation. That was his whole intention. And Mercy didn't quite understand that. Perhaps because she's too immature, she's too young, or maybe she's just too stubborn. Another possible theme is that loved ones will do what is best for us, even when we don't agree. So again, thinking about what Poppy did, right, sacrificed his pride, which is something that Mercy did not agree with, all right? But sometimes, you know, and I think about the big picture here, I'm sure Poppy thought it'd be best to sacrifice his pride so that Mercy could have that free tuition to Seaward Pines. Another possible theme is that having money makes people believe that they are better than others, right? We think about, for instance, those soccer girls who seem to look down on, you know, Mercy, Rolly, and Poppy because, you know, they're painters and, you know, they speak English, but they still speak their native language, which is Spanish. All right, let's go to some guiding questions. So these guiding questions are intended to help you with the pre-writing graphic organizer. So if you need to go back and, you know, kind of revisit your ideas, if you've already submitted that work, I did provide you with feedback. You can check that out on Google Classroom. I've returned those assignments to those who have submitted them and completed the work. So guiding questions are, what did the father do or not do that confused Mercy? What was his motive? Why did he not explain this to Mercy? So again, kind of going back to what I said before, he did not stand up to the soccer girls. And his motive was to, again, protect Mercy's tuition, which was going to be covered if they completed the painting job in the gymnasium. And why didn't he explain this to Mercy? Well, he never was given the opportunity. Mercy was too stubborn to, you know, allow him to explain his point of view, which again, thinking back, why is it difficult to understand other people? It's because we fail to recognize their point of view because we're too stubborn. Why didn't the soccer girls understand what they did was wrong would be upsetting to the family? Well, again, thinking back to what I had said before, that they've probably been conditioned to treat those who, you know, appear less wealthy than they are, right, in a bad way. So they've probably been conditioned by their parents to treat poor people poorly or disrespectfully. I don't know. Again, they probably didn't understand that what they did was wrong because A, they're not poor, and B, they probably speak English as their native language. Again, let's not forget that they were really mocking Mercy and Rolly with the whole, you know, excusez-moi, I think that's some of the other phrases they said. But again, they were speaking French to them, and they're Hispanic. So again, this is, it's just total disrespect. All right, so that's a review of the Prezi. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to stop sharing this tab. I'm going to close this tab out. Bye-bye now. And, oh, I forgot to show you guys today's post. Well, I'll take it to today's post now since I do want to show you guys that new file. So here's today's post again. I just accessed the Prezi here. All right, you can access the questions that you're going to answer, the assessment questions through Common Lit. You also have the paper copy of the text with the questions. And then over here is the Soul Painting Ink annotations, which I'm going to take you to now. So here are my annotations for Soul Painting Ink. I'm just going to blow this up, make it a little bit bigger. And what you'll see is, you know, you kind of have to use the paragraph number as a guide. All right, so I didn't start annotating. I didn't have any annotations up till paragraph. This would be 19, 18, 17. So for paragraph 17, I said, Mercy's thoughts reveal that she doesn't truly understand her brother's love for science, which, as you recall, I brought that up during yesterday's discussion. In paragraph 22, I took note of Mercy's thoughts here. It says, further evidence that she doesn't understand nor appreciate her brother's love of science. I know you can't see that because it got chopped out. Going to paragraph 24, I just took note of the fact that Mercy's in seventh grade and Rolly is a senior, which, again, we know that through the Prezi. In paragraph 25, I took note of this set of sentences. It said that Seaward Pines is some kind of a private school. Mercy describes it as being fancy. It's not her cup of tea, so again, she doesn't really seem to like it. In paragraph 26, we discover that Mercy struggles in school. Her parents think sending her to Seaward Pines is the right move. Continuing on, this is paragraph 31. I took note of this sentence. It's kind of hard for me to see that, but it says I'm 12, so for now I mostly do the trim, and I'm not allowed to go on all the jobs on account of child labor laws and all that. So I really just highlighted that sentence. I didn't take a note because I just wanted to recognize that, all right, she's 12 years old, because it helps me to understand her maturity level and helps me to understand her point of view or perspective a bit more because she's so young. Paragraph 45, I took a note on this entire paragraph because this is where Poppy tells Mercy and Rolly they are working at Seaward Pines in exchange for free tuition, which is, again, the cost to attend school. So this is where we learn about the deal that was made between Poppy and Seaward Pines. Paragraph 52, I took note of this sentence because it says Mercy has a lot of respect and admiration for Poppy. She expresses several positive feelings about him, and they seem to have a strong relationship. All right, and I get that intention, get that idea, I was able to make that inference from these three sentences, particularly the one that says he's the strongest dad I know. All right, earlier on, we also know that she wants to take over his business, even has business cards, you know, kind of planned out and all that. In paragraph 71, I took note of this sentence because it seems to foreshadow a future event. It says, be sure to mark the work area. We don't want any of the students tripping on a drop cloth and having an accident. This was said by Mrs. McDaniels when she shows them the job site. And this kind of foreshadowed that something was going to happen, right? That somebody was probably not going to follow the sign they put up. And as we know later on in the story, that's what happens. Paragraph 75, I took note of most of the paragraph. It says, Rolly seems embarrassed to be working at the school, probably because he is going to be a senior. All right, so again, thinking about the fact that he wants to rush to get out of there, right? He's telling Mercy to hurry up and all that. He's rolling faster and faster, right? And again, he's a senior. These are, you know, there's athletes who are practicing who will see him, so he's probably trying to avoid being bullied. All right, let's not forget, he's really smart, so unfortunately, he doesn't seem to be athletic, so he probably, has a hard time socially. I mean, let's face it, too. He's into dead things. He was talking about decomposition. All right. I just realized I don't think I'm presenting right now. I do apologize for that, guys. Again, first time using this particular tool, so I do apologize. As I'm about halfway through the gallery, and of course, that's what I recognize But hey, these things are going to happen. All right, so I have got, I'm right up over here now. I think it's the 7th slide. All right, and again, I do apologize if you were not able to see that and you're relying on the video, but you could just easily, I'm sure, rewind and pull them up on your screen. So going back now, this is paragraph 89, 88, 87. So 87 and 88, I took note of the fact that it seems like the soccer team is purposely ruining the paint job. Mercy seems intimidated by them. So again, I highlighted these sentences because, again, it seems like they're doing what they did on purpose, right? Damn, she stares at her palms, then gives me an ugly look like it's my fault. And then one of the girls next to her giggles, oops. So that line right there, the one that I highlighted, really helps me to understand that they probably did this on purpose and they don't feel sorry at all, right? They don't have any remorse. So then I highlighted this. I'm furious, just again, because I'm getting the sense that, you know, this is where we're seeing a bit of a change in Mercy's behavior. And I took note of the fact down here that Rowley doesn't come to help her. So again, that's probably why she's also furious. Although it's not the only reason why. I think she's more mad at the soccer girls than she is mad at her brother. Then I took note of paragraph 91. Mercy expects that Poppy is going to come and scold the soccer team because, again, we get this expectation from her that her dad's coming over and, you know, going to give them the business to make a fuss. Later on, paragraph 95, I took note of the fact that the soccer team makes an even bigger mess of the paint job. All right, so again, they kind of destroy all of the painting, really. They're mixing the colors and all that. Total mess. Then again, I took note in paragraph 96 of the fact that Mercy is still expecting her father to yell at them. And then paragraph 97, I highlighted these sentences. It reads, but as the seconds tick by, absolutely nothing happens. I finally turn to see that Poppy has stopped in his tracks, his hands in his pockets as he watches the girls race past. So again, this is where I'm seeing that turning point where Mercy is realizing her father is not going to do anything. And in paragraph 101, I took note of the first sentence, but it's Poppy's stillness that makes me feel worse. It says, Mercy is furious with the girls' behavior and for Poppy not holding them accountable. All right, so the fact that he doesn't react only makes her madder. Paragraphs 105 and 106 are where we see that Mercy doesn't understand why Poppy is acting to understanding of the whole situation. She's a bit surprised and she's disappointed by his lack of reaction and the fact that he's not going to hold the girls accountable. You know, he tells Mercy to be quiet when Mercy suggests that the soccer girls clean it up to Mr. Falco. Then in paragraph 113, I took some note on the first few sentences. I said, Mercy doesn't seem to understand why Poppy is letting the girls get away with their behavior. And finally, paragraphs 129 and 130 and 31, I took note and said that Raleigh understands why Poppy acted the way he did. He explains to Mercy that if her father had reacted, she would have lost her free ride, so she would have lost her tuition to Seaward Pines. Also, I took note of the fact that Mercy feels guilty for ignoring Poppy for the rest of the day and begins to understand the sacrifice he was trying to make. All right, so hopefully, again, the annotations were helpful. That's a new thing I'm going to try to feature, particularly for these longer texts, because obviously there's a lot to annotate. There's a lot to read here. It is a much longer text that we're reading. All right, just going to pop over my shoulder here. We did the Prezi. We went over some of my annotations. Now I'm going to take you to the common lit guided reading questions. Now, again, I'm not going to reread the text, all right? If you want that guided reading, please visit yesterday's video where I really filled in some of the blanks and helped to track your understanding. The guiding questions, again, do the same thing, all right? So I'm going to click on the guiding questions now. And you'll see that every few paragraphs will have something that looks like this. Again, I went over this the other day, but once you click on that, the question projects over here. And even if you get the question wrong, it's totally fine. It will lead you to the right answer. So there are 8 guiding questions that we're going to go through right now. These, again, are just basic comprehension questions to help you to track your understanding and make sure you're getting what you need to get out of the reading. So the first question says, what does the line "wants him to be a doctor" in paragraph one reveal about Bobby's view of his son? He wants to be like him. He wants Rolly to be successful. He does not want Rolly to make goals. He does not want Rolly to go after his dreams. Well, if he wants his son to be a doctor, all right, he doesn't want Rolly to be like him because Poppy is a painter. So we know that it is D. He wants Rolly to be successful. So again, Poppy has very high hopes for Rolly because Rolly, again, is very intelligent and does well in school. Question number two, which belongs to paragraph 30. And again, these questions are paced out, so you know you don't want to look beyond the stopping point for the answer. You want to look before, really between the two sections. So the next question says, what is Mercy's point of view of attending Seaward Pines? Well, as I recall, I don't think she's necessarily worried about going. All right, meaning like she doesn't want to go there because she's not going to do well or something like that. I think she simply does not want to go. I think it's B. All right, she's not curious about going because she's not too excited about it. In D, she does not have an opinion would mean that she doesn't really care. She does care because in paragraph 30, you know, she says that she brokered a deal or she made a deal between her and her parents that would, you know, allow her to go to Seaward Pines as long as she could apprentice for her dad at his painting business. But in reality, she didn't broker a deal. Her parents are making her go even though she doesn't want to. So the answer is B. Continuing on to question three, belongs to paragraph 45. Why did Poppy trade the painting job for Mercy's tuition? Well, the answer comes down to this. Poppy cannot afford the tuition otherwise. Let's remember that Rolly is going to Seaward Pines on a scholarship. And that's the only reason why he's able to go there is because he's on a scholarship. All right. If he didn't have that scholarship, he wouldn't be going there. The other answers don't make much sense. Poppy wants to play a trick on the school. Well, that's not what happens. That's as we know, and that's not his intention. The school requires all families to trade work for tuition. That's not true. The school is more concerned with appearance than money, so the school's more worried about how it looks when compared to money. Well, I'm going to be honest, guys. Most private schools could care less how they look. They're more worried about making sure they're making money. Question four belongs to paragraph 52. Again, to count paragraphs, just count from between the fives. All right, every five, they number the paragraph, so 51, 52. It says, which statement best describes Mercy's relationship with her father? A, she thinks he's demanding. B, she's embarrassed by him. C, she views him as weak. D, she looks up to him. Well, here, I get the sense that she looks up to him, all right? She mentions that he's the strongest dad I know, and earlier on, she mentions how she wants to, you know, apprentice in his painting business and eventually take it over. She might think he's demanding, but that doesn't, you know, there's no evidence that really shows that. She's embarrassed by him. Well, she's not embarrassed by him, not at least at this point of the story. We know later on she feels a bit embarrassed. And C, she views him as weak. All right, again, she just said he's the strongest dad I know. How could that be true? All right, question number five, rolling on, belongs to paragraph 77. The question reads, which statement best describes Rolly's behavior throughout the painting job at the school? Now, let's remember, Rolly's going to be a senior at this school. You know, he's probably not very comfortable being there. You know, there's soccer girls practicing. Maybe he's got a crush on one of them. Again, the football players are practicing. Maybe they're, you know, maybe they've been hazing him a bit for being the smart kid or the nerd. So which statement would best describe his behavior? I wouldn't say he's curious because, again, he knows the school in and out. He's been going there. You know, it's nothing new to him. He appears anxious or he appears uncomfortable. All right, or embarrassed, perhaps. C, Rolly appears confident. Again, I don't think he appears confident. At least he doesn't project that in any way. Again, he seems to kind of run and hide when Mercy is watching the whole soccer thing. Well, where is that? I just want to bring that back. Right here. But then I turn back to ask Rolly. He's gone. Again, he doesn't even want to see the practice. He gets right to work because you know, I don't think he's feeling very confident around all these classmates. Lastly, Raleigh appears frightened. There's a big difference between being frightened and anxious, okay? Frightened means you're scared, right? You fear for your safety. Anxious means you're just uncomfortable. So I'm going to say that Raleigh was uncomfortable throughout the painting job at the school. And let's not forget that he also seems to kind of turn and hide when the soccer girls come busting through the door and ruining the paint. Which brings us to our next question. Why does Raleigh keep his back turned from Mercy and the soccer team? Well, to say he's annoyed would be inaccurate, okay? I don't think he's annoyed at the soccer team or Mercy. I think he's just, again, feeling uncomfortable. He's anxious, right? He's embarrassed, which is our correct answer. He doesn't notice them would be facetious, right? They're in the same gymnasium, all right? He definitely is aware of what's going on. In D, he's focused on his work. I don't think he's so focused on his work as that he is embarrassed, okay? While he might be focused on trying to get that work done quickly, I think more than anything, he doesn't want to turn around and show his face because he's embarrassed. He doesn't want the girls to see that his little sister is giving them a hard time. Even though they deserve it. If that was my little sister, I probably wouldn't keep my back turned. Just saying. All right, question 7 deals with paragraph 110. It says, how does Poppy's reaction to the soccer team affect Mercy's point of view? So how does his reaction affect her point of view or her attitude or feelings towards him? She is now proud of and confident in her dad. I would not say that's accurate, all right? That's how she felt before this whole situation. She is now frustrated and hurt by her brother. Well, that doesn't answer the question because we want to know how his reaction affects Mercy's point of view towards him, not her brother. She doesn't seem to have any issues with her brother. She's now annoyed by and worried about her brother. Again, deals with her brother. D, she is now confused and embarrassed by her father. That is the correct answer. All right, she doesn't understand why he's not holding the girls accountable. Last but not least is question 8. How is Rolly's perspective of his dad's actions different from Mercy's? A, Rolly views their dad's action as something that will harm the family. All right, so again, we want to understand with this question how Rolly and Mercy's perspective or points of view about their dad's actions are different. All right, I don't think Rolly views what the father did as something that's going to harm the family. All right, Rolly views their dad's actions as a sacrifice for his children. I think that seems pretty on point, right? Because Rolly does understand that dad was, you know, keeping quiet and let his pride kind of be ashamed because of the fact that he didn't respond to the girls. And he reacted that way because he didn't want Mercy to go without the education she needed, all right? He was worried that if he confronted the girls, he was going to, perhaps lose the job and lose the opportunity to get free tuition for Mercy. Rolly views their dad's actions as embarrassing. Again, that's more so how I think Mercy feels about the situation, not Rolly. Rolly views their dad's actions as selfish. Again, I don't think Rolly views it in that way because he understands that dad was sacrificing for his children, right? He was not being selfish. Nothing about what he did was for himself, right? To say his actions are selfish is kind of facetious because he's not charging the school. He's not getting any money out of this, right? He's making sure that Mercy gets the education she needs. He's doing this job. He's painting this for nothing for Mercy. So the correct answer here is going to be B. Rolly views the dad's actions as a sacrifice for his children. All right, let's get to the assessment questions and wrap things up for today. So our questions read, 1, how does the author develop Mercy's point of view in paragraphs 97 through 101? So again, if you click on these hyperlinks, if you're working on Common Lit, it actually highlights the section that you're supposed to be looking at, which is really neat. So your options are A, through her reaction to the school secretary. B, they develop Mercy's point of view by showing her reaction to Rolly's response to the soccer team. C, they develop Mercy's point of view through the words and dialogue she speaks to Rolly and her father. Or D, the author develops Mercy's point of view by sharing her inner thoughts and observations of her father's actions. Again, guys, let's not forget in the skill focus that authors develop people's point of view, or develop the character's point of view, I should say, through actions, dialogue, or thoughts. All right. So what is it? What is it that reveals or helps us to develop? What does the author use to develop Mercy's point of view? How does he reveal that? Is it through Mercy's actions? Is it through her dialogue? Is it through her thoughts? Make sure you read your options here very carefully. Number two, how does the author develop Rolly's point of view in paragraphs 125 through 131? So again, the author develops the character's point of view through actions, dialogue, or thoughts. We need to keep in mind that Rolly is not the narrator, so we're not revealed to his thoughts. This is first-person narration that the author uses. It's told through Mercy's point of view. So any answer here that says, you know, by sharing Rolly's thoughts would be inaccurate. So we have option A, by showing his reaction to what Mercy does. B, the author develops Rolly's point of view by sharing his inner thoughts with the reader. Well, I'll tell you right now, guys, it's not B. We don't get Rolly's inner thoughts because he's not the narrator. C, the author develops Rolly's point of view through the words and dialogue he speaks to Mercy. Again, we're looking at this section. D, the author develops Rolly's point of view through his reaction to what his father says and does. Question three, over the course of the story, Mercy's point of view, or Mercy's view of her dad, changes because, so, you know, what changes her perspective or her view or her point of view of her dad? Is it she's confused and hurt by her dad's reaction to disrespect? She is frustrated that the job is going to take longer than expected. She is upset that he gave Rolly more responsibility on the job site than her. D, she does not understand why he would choose to send her to Seaward Pines. What changes her view of her dad? Four, which piece of evidence best reveals Mercy's changing perspective toward her dad? So again, this is like an evidence question for number three. So, you know, thinking about what causes her view of him to change and which piece of evidence here would show her changing perspective of her dad. Is it A, the whole sky reflects in Poppy's paint-speckled shades as he looks over and smiles? Is it B, Poppy can carry several cans in each hand, he's the strongest dad I know? C, why didn't he say anything? He's Poppy, he's the boss, an adult, the guy in charge, how could he let this happen? Or D, it doesn't take that long to touch up the walls or to repaint the door, but I'm furious just the same. So again, which piece of evidence here best reveals Mercy's changing perspective or changing view toward her dad? Last question is a short answer. It's number five. How do Mercy and Rolly view their Poppy's reaction to the soccer team differently? How does the author develop these two points of view? So again, guys, don't just tell me, you know, what Mercy and what Rolly's point of view or perspective of their dad's reaction is, right? You also need to tell me how the author develops these points of view, all right? So how do we know Rolly's view about their Poppy's actions? Is it through his dialogue? Is it through his actions? Is it through his thoughts? It's not through his not thoughts. He's not the narrator, guys. Or is it, you know, same thing goes for Mercy. What helps us understand Mercy's view about Poppy's reaction? Is it the dialogue she shares? Is it the thoughts she shares? Is it her actions? Okay. So, folks, with that being said, we're going to wrap things up for today. Tomorrow, we're going to have our draft lesson on our unit number one essay. So I'm going to go over some materials with that. We'll talk about the prompt. We'll revisit my pre-writing graphic organizer, talk about, you know, how that work correlates with the essay. Again, if you've been keeping up with that graphic organizer and, you know, being very thoughtful on that, then your essay is pretty much going to write itself because you're coming up with your claims in that first column for each text as far as making that connection between the text and the essential question. And then in the right column where you're, you know, jotting down your evidence, that's the evidence you can pull into this essay. So it should be relatively easy if you've been keeping up with that pre-writing graphic organizer. And just keep in mind that tomorrow's a draft. So even if it's not a complete product by tomorrow, or by the end of the day tomorrow, that's okay, because on Friday, we'll be talking about feedback, all right? And if you would like to participate in one of my live sessions, I could, you know, give you some verbal feedback on your work, on your essay. If you're submitting digitally, I can provide you with feedback there. If you're not submitting digitally, it's hard for me to give you feedback, but perhaps maybe, again, we could snap a photo of it. You can email it to me. There are ways to get around that. But until tomorrow, I will see you guys then. Make sure that you have yourselves a great afternoon, another beautiful day out there. Loving this time of year. Sun shines out. I think Friday it's supposed to hit 78 degrees, which is exciting. It is Memorial Day weekend, so I'm very much looking forward to that. And last but not least, let's make sure to wash our hands, and we'll have some good vibrations to play us out, so to speak, as Bill O'Reilly once said. Seems like I'm having some issues playing the video at the end here. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to stop presenting. And I'm going to present just that video. Wow, I definitely got to get better at producing these outros. Oh my lord. Hopefully that's working. Oh boy. I'm going to have quite the blooper reel at the end of all this. Well, guys, it's not presenting. I don't know what's going on with these outros. I'm going to get down to the bottom of this. But until tomorrow, have yourselves a great afternoon. Peace and love. Take care, guys. Have a good one.